actually what he's talking about is really important, mm-hmm. because there have been a lot of photographs, there has been a lot of talk for the last 2 years that a lot of things are dying, like starfish are like melting.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, there are a lot of dead fish, whales, mm-hmm. dolphins in that specific area.
Wow.
So I believe it's cause for concern. So I'm just going to read a little bit of a quote from the article that he posted.
Okay.
And he says, when I wrote my last article about Fukushima, I got a lot of heat for being an alarmist and for supposedly scaring people unnecessarily. I didn't think that an article about Fukushima would touch such a nerve, but apparently there are some people out there that really do not want anyone writing about this stuff. Right now, massive numbers of fish and sea creatures are dying in the Pacific Ocean. In addition, independent tests have shown that significant levels of cesium-137 are in a very high percentage of fish that are being caught in the Pacific and sold in North America, which is this area in particular. I mean, I think that there's something to be said about it. I mean, with the radiation leaking into the ocean.
Right, yeah.
I think that it's something to be concerned about, specifically for pescatarians. And we get a lot of our fish from that area, so I think people should be aware of that, mm-hmm. and keep an eye on that. I mean, what do you think?
I mean, first of all, people would be dumb not to think that, you know, the tragedy that happened over there would not affect the sea life. Like, it's common sense, you know what I mean? And to not really address it is wrong. It's, you know, I bet you it just all boils down to money. And I do remember reading, like, every now and again, I read about, like, deformed animals washing up in California that are coming over through, you know, through from that area. So, mm-hmm. I mean, we have to be smart and we have to pay attention. We can't believe everything that we're told, because history has proven that, you know, the government, corporations will lie to us just so they can continue to make money.
But it only makes sense that, mm-hmm. that, you know, the sea life in that area is going to be affected.
Exactly.
It only makes sense. And I actually saw a YouTube video, mm-hmm. where this guy was, he was taking readings of radiation, mm-hmm. by a California beach, and mm-hmm. he was on the boardwalk, mm-hmm. and then he walked closer towards the ocean, mm-hmm. and it started going up really high and making this crackly noise. So I'm saying to myself, that's not cool.
Yeah, and I mean, it's not only the sea life that's affected. I know they've been talking about babies being born with deformities. I've read a couple of things. I mean, I won't speak too much because I don't have a source on that, but I'm just saying that we have to be smart about this. We have to know that type of radiation leak, you know, is going to cause issues to our environment.
Absolutely.
Period.
I mean, I'm wondering what's going on with the folks in Japan, like who are directly in the vicinity of that whole tragedy. Like, what is going on? Like, are people going to be affected health-wise? Like, I haven't heard too much about that. I want to do a little bit more research
about
that.
I think we should.
Keep hearing about the sea life, but I'm not sure what's going on with the people in that area.
Right.
I would think that they're affected.
And sometimes I feel like you're told that, oh, it's okay, it's safe to come back, and without there really being any real research, you know, like, due diligence is not, you know, it's just about...
I think that there probably is research being done, but I think it's just being maybe hushed up. I'm not really sure. That's just my best guess.
Yeah, I think we should revisit that for sure and let people know.
Oh, definitely.
Because we're not hearing about it. It's not at the forefront in the news anymore, and we tend to forget.
Yeah,
we're on
to
the next thing.
It was 2 years ago.
Exactly. So. Yep. So, well, thank you for sharing that. This is very informative. I had no idea. So, where are we at? 9:25. We have 5 minutes.
All right. So.
All right. And we have our next segment, which is...
Dinner for $10.
Which is awesome.
I love the sound effect.
I know.
Cute. Really cute.
I was just saying the same thing. All right, dinner for $10. What is it, you ask? Well, Nina and I come up with meals to help, you know, help you save a few pennies. So, Nina, what do you have for us today?
So, today I decided to do chili con carne, which is beans yet again.
Okay.
Seems like beans are the theme for the day. So, basically, okay, so what I did was... I did it, instead of per serving, I did it per ingredients. Mm-hmm. I didn't include the price of the staple ingredients because... They are staple ingredients that I use in my home, and I always have them.
Mm-hmm.
But my dinner for... Okay, so I have... Let me see. A pound of ground beef.
Okay.
For $3.49.
Mm-hmm.
A 16-ounce bag of fresh beans because I like to make them fresh. Mm-hmm. I think it just tastes better that way.
Okay.
And I don't have to rinse off like extra sodium.
Mm-hmm.
What else? 8 ounces of extra sharp cheddar on sale. Like on sale.
Yes.
And mm-hmm. that comes up to $7.77 total.
That's a good.
It's a good price. Although great. I do add, if I were to add garlic, mm-hmm. if I were to add onion, which I do.
Yeah. Yep.
And peppers, it still comes under $10. And then what I also like to do is after I prepare it is I like to dice up some onion
mm-hmm.
and some cilantro and sprinkle it on top, which I think I did that for you once
on one
of the dishes.
It was very delicious.
Raw
mm-hmm.
tastes unbelievable. And you can also add a little sour cream, you know, if you mm-hmm. want to as well.
That sounds good. That
and
sounds
it comes
delicious.
To just a little bit over $10 if you add the sour cream.
Okay.
But that's not a staple in my home, but I didn't include it.
Maybe you can get it on sale sometime. You know, like, you know, choose to use
it. No, absolutely.
Yeah.
Everybody's not into sour cream in their chili con carne, but, you know, I like it, but I don't eat beans anymore. So, anyway, so what's your dinner for $10?
Okay, so one of the dishes that I like to make is curry chicken, and I'll switch it up. Either
You've made it for me before.
Yeah, we did it from one of the specialty dishes.
So yummy.
So I just wanted to revisit it because I thought it'd be a great suggestion for people who are trying to make a fat. It's a quick dish. It's inexpensive. And it's tasty. And I don't make it spicy, but there are options to make it spicy.
Sure.
And, you know, I've made it with brown rice, but you can also make it with white rice if you prefer that, or pasta. It's up to you. So the curry chicken, so I break it down. The total that it comes up to is $9.79.
Okay.
And this is by me kind of looking at the circular at the local supermarket and finding sales. So chicken legs for $5.16.
Okay.
That's a family pack of chicken legs.
Okay.
Brown rice, $1.79, and that's a store brand, you know, brown
okay.
rice. Thyme, 99 cents. Now, what I love to do is use fresh thyme. It just tastes so much better, than the one the dried. Also, curry powder. And you can buy it in the bag. It's like they have these little bags as opposed
to... I love curry
powder. You buy it in the jar, it's like $4, but I get it for $1.19 in the bag.
Okay.
And scallions.
Okay.
Now, you can also use onions.
Yeah.
You can, like I said, you can add, like, I think it's Scotch bell pepper that gives it that kick a lot of times if you want a spicy version of curry chicken. But, you know, this is how I make it because I have a little one, and I can't make the food too spicy for her.
Okay.
And everyone really enjoys this dish, so.
What I love about curry powder, by mm-hmm. the way, is you can buy 3 or 4 different curry powders, and they
yes.
all taste completely different.
Yeah.
That's what I love about curry
Not
powder.
Only that, but you can also take that curry powder, and you can put it in a vegetarian dish. Like, I'm not
sure.
eating chicken, so I can make a curry, like a vegetable dish, curry vegetable dish. So it's great to kind of
potatoes, by the way.
Switch up the taste a little
it's
bit.
Great potatoes. You need to try it.
Mm.
Seriously.
Just some, like, curried potatoes?
You
like,
can
how,
do mm-hmm.
like, baking, boiling...
You can boil them and mash
mm-hmm.
them and add the curry powder.
Ooh.
It tastes really great.
Interesting.
With
curry
your,
mashed potatoes.
With your butter substitute.
Oh, yes.
That
Olivia.
Butter substitute that you like to use. Yeah.
Yes, Olivia. That
really,
is the bomb.
Good.
All right. So we are coming up on our second segment. We'll be coming back with our special guest. I'm very excited. And I want to remind our folks to call in 646-929-1521. And, you know, listen in, ask questions. So you're listening to Food Wrap on the GoPro Radio Network, and we'll be right back.
The views and opinions expressed on GoPro Radio Network shows are solely those of the speakers and are not necessarily the views or opinions of GoPro Radio Networks, Inc. or its affiliates. These broadcasts are provided on the understanding that they do not constitute professional advice or services. Individuals who speak in these broadcasts express their own opinions, experiences, and conclusions. GoPro Radio Networks and its affiliates do not necessarily endorse or oppose any particular opinion or conclusion discussed in these broadcasts. You may not edit, modify, or redistribute these broadcasts in any way without the express permission of GoPro Radio Networks, Inc. GoPro Radio Networks assumes no liability for any of your activities in connection with these broadcasts or for your use of these broadcasts in connection with your website, computer, or playing device.
You're listening to content developed by the GoPro Radio Network, the fastest growing network in the galaxy. GoPro Radio Network. Listen to the voices in your head.
All right, we are back. Today's special on the menu is your food killing you? It sounds a little dramatic, but, you know, it well, can be. It can be.
We want to drive the point home.
Exactly.
Know what I mean?
With special guest, award-winning poet, actor, and writer, Carlos Andres Gomez. I don't say it as good as you.
Carlos Andres Gomez.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. From New York. He is the author of a coming-of-age memoir, Man Up, Reimagining Modern Manhood, which was released in 2012. It was nominated for the Pushcart Prize and named Artist of the Year at the 2009 Promoting Outstanding Writers Award. Carlos co-starred in Spike Lee's number one movie, Inside Man, with Denzel Washington, Jodie Foster, and Clive Owen. He is recently in the third season of TV One's Versus and Flow. He has lectured and performed at more than 200 colleges and universities, facilitated countless workshops, and delivered numerous keynotes and commencement addresses. Today we will be discussing how food allergies are on the rise and how they affected his health and how he turned from being sick to healthy through a change in diet as well as various other upcoming projects. That is very long intro, but we're so happy to have Carlos here with us today. Welcome, Carlos.
Thank you so much for having me on. It's great to chat with you all.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
So Nina, why don't you start us off? I know you had some great questions for Carlos.
All right, so why don't you, I mean, did we miss anything? Or did you want to say anything else?
No,
can we get to the questions? So, okay, so tell us your story. Like, tell us what happened. Like, how did you realize that you had certain food allergies? What age? Like, give us some insight on that.
Yeah, it was a pretty dramatic journey for me. I was, I started having health issues when I was 14 years old. Wow. And they kept getting worse, and we didn't know what was wrong, and I went to a number of different doctors, and things got really bad when I was about 15 years old, and over a six-month period, I lost 48 pounds.
Wow.
Oh, my goodness.
And this is, you know, out of nowhere. I mean, I was, you know, I thought I was a healthy kid. I was a basketball player. I was an athlete, and, wow, of course, as I was losing all this weight, my mother was panicking, and I was having, you know, pasta four times a day. She was trying to fill me up with carbs and give me, you know, she's saying, oh, you're not eating enough, you're exercising too much.
That was probably part of the problem.
All these absurd theories. And I went to every kind of doctor you can think of. I went to homeopathic doctors and gastroenterologists and spiritual healers and Reiki therapy and everything you can imagine all across the map. And, of course, you know, traditional doctors, and finally, when I finally went to the ninth doctor, I got some blood tests, and they found out that I had severe food intolerances to a whole range of foods that are found in pretty much everything.
Wow.
And so the things I found that I had severe food intolerances to were plátanos, bananas.
Oh, my goodness.
Those aren't everything, but in most things that I was eating.
Oh, my goodness. That's terrible. For a Latino, that's terrible.
I know. It was very – that was one of the toughest ones.
That's devastating.
Wheat gluten, which, of course, was in all the pasta and most of the carbohydrates
bread.
I was eating. Mm-hmm. Peanuts, mushrooms,
wow,
soybeans.
That's
it was
crazy.
A whole list of things. And
goodness.
After finding this out, I started doing rotating foods that I'd been eating out, eating a lot at home. And when I took the foods that made me sick out, all the weight came, you know, I put all the weight back on, and I felt fantastic for the first time in a couple of years. By that point, we figured out I was probably about 16 and a half, and all the weight started to come back on. And a lot of the other side effects that I had because of my food, I was really depressed. I was just very sickly and just not of sound body, mind, spirit, anything. And with all the different people that I met with, I mean, they thought I was dying. They thought I had cancer. They thought I had diabetes. I got diagnosed with bipolar disorder.
That's crazy.
From one session with a psychiatrist, when she heard about the physical symptoms that I'd been going through, she basically was like, you're in denial, you're depressive, bipolar, you have been clinically depressed, and that's why you lost this weight, and you're in denial about it. And I wasn't even, at that point, I wasn't even sad. I was like, no, I'm losing all this weight. I don't know what's wrong with me.
Wow, that's crazy.
So it took me on this really transformative, and it was a wild trip that I went on with my food allergies, and it had a big impact at a very pivotal time in my life, being a teenager as well.
And this is something I actually read about this in your book. And, you know, I was just amazed at, you know, because it could be, it's so frustrating, A, not knowing, you know, what's wrong with you. But it's even more frustrating when people are trying to tell you something is wrong with you that's not really wrong with you. Like you're depressed, you're bipolar. I mean, I can't imagine what that experience was like. You know, I'm just curious, how has, just over the years, how have you coped with having so many food allergies? How has your diet changed? Do you still feel like you can enjoy food, you know, the same way?
It's a very surprising impact that my food intolerances have had that I think is very unexpected to most people when they hear about how I've reacted to having all these things that I can't eat. Instead of making me enjoy food less, it's actually made me enjoy food a lot more. Looking back on it now, I actually say that food allergies has been the greatest gift to my life, because every single meal that I have, I relish it, I cherish it, and I'm so appreciative in a way that I see people and they say, oh, you know, this piece of cake is all right, you know, this cookie is that stuff, it just blows my mind. Because I couldn't have wheat gluten in the era where they said, oh, you want something wheat gluten free, and they'd hand you a bowl of carrots and a warm glass of water. That was gluten free in the era that I was gluten free. You know, now gluten free, I mean, they make, you know, chocolate croissants, you know, they mm-hmm. make you know, handmade tortellini, they make all this crazy stuff. But in my era, it was carrots. It was boiled chicken. You know, that was gluten free. So I'm incredibly appreciative of the foods that I can eat now. And like I was just saying, in this era where it's now very hip to be gluten free, and a lot of people are not eating gluten because they say they feel better, or they just don't want to have it, or because it's trendy, whatever that might be. There's so many options now, and there's some really great foods that are out there where, you know, a lot of it's a lot more expensive than the regular stuff, but there's so many options that you have now. Whereas, you know, when I was in the late 90s struggling with this, there were much, much fewer options, and not really any options at all.
Carlos, let me ask you a question. Do you think that GMOs are linked to some of your food intolerances? Do you think that had something
definitely
to do with it? And could you please tell us some of your symptoms other than the weight loss? Did you have other symptoms as well?
Yeah, I mean, I had a lot. The thing is, the symptoms, this is something that I actually found out when I would talk to doctors about all the symptoms that I was going through, is that when I gave them my symptoms, they thought I had diabetes, HIV, cancer, I mean, thyroid imbalance. Because here's the thing, when your body is not well, mm-hmm. and when your immune system is compromised, which is when any serious illness happens and your immune system is struggling and trying to hold on, mm-hmm. the symptoms are very much the same. So, I mean, people thought I had chronic fatigue syndrome, which I had all the symptoms of it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I had energy that was so low that I would actually tell my body to get out of bed, and none of my arms, my legs, nothing would listen to what my mind was telling it, and I actually couldn't physically remove myself from a bed. I know that sounds very dramatic to somebody who hasn't experienced the kind of physical fatigue mm-hmm. that I'm talking about, but, you know, when I was at my worst, there were some days I actually couldn't get out of bed. Mm-hmm. I have ocular migraines. Wow. I had joint pain. Like I said, all the weight loss. I mean, as all these things seem to accumulate, all these different symptoms, I did get very depressed. This is actually after I talked to the psychiatrist. but when I actually wasn't depressed at all when I first saw her. But there were a lot of symptoms. Pretty much any symptom you can think of that would be really devastating. And I mean, I was a ghost. I was a ghost walking around. If you see pictures of me then, I was probably, you know, before I got really sick, I was maybe 4 or 5 pounds lighter than I am now. Mm. And I had not 1 ounce of muscle on me. So I was like a little bit of like a husky kid.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time I'd had this, I was probably 3 or 4 inches shorter. By the time I got really sick and I was trying to come out of it, I weighed 126 pounds. I
wow.
looked like I was dying.
Oh
my pants were probably half. Yeah, my waist was half the size of the waistband on my pants that I'd be wearing. So it was a really dramatic shift.
Now,
I looked like I'd been starved or been tucked away on abandoned island somewhere.
Your book is called Man Up, and I did get a chance to read it, and I thought it was beautiful because it basically addresses this whole notion that, you know, men can't have feelings, or you know what I mean. We know that whole macho syndrome that, you know, our men feel like they have to have so
especially
they can
Latino
appear
men.
Very strong. Exactly.
Especially Latino men.
So I'm just curious how, you know, as far as health is concerned, how much do you feel like that plays a role in our men getting the help that they need? You know, whether it be they're having symptoms with, you know, as far as food allergies are concerned or mental health issues or, you know, so on and so forth. How do you feel like that kind of machismo plays a role in that?
That's a great question. The chapter in which I talk about struggling with my food intolerances mm-hmm. is called Weakness, The Death of Superman.
Mm-hmm.
And in it I talk a lot about how my whole life I aspired to be this, like many men that I know, this macho alpha male mm-hmm. Superman, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
And it took me getting very sick, losing all this weight, and my body breaking down to realize that really strong men and really strong human beings
mm-hmm.
are the people who acknowledge when they can't do things alone and the ones that reach their hand out and ask for help for someone. It's the people who stay by themselves, refuse to ask for help. Those are the people that are not tough because they
right.
die. And what I
True.
Found out is the people who, if you want to be tough, you got to live.
Yes.
And if you don't ask for help, that's not a good recipe for survival. And when you really are at your worst and when you face a serious illness that really humbles you
mm-hmm.
and you're not able to physically get out of bed in the morning, you can't do that alone. You can't just stay in your bed. If I had stayed on that path and if I hadn't had my mom advocating for me and being by my side and my father advocating for me, I who knows what would have happened, but it was something that we all did together as a team. And I think it really saddened me because there's so many amazing men that I've known, and whether we're talking about addiction or we're talking about illness,
mm-hmm.
A lot of men see it as an admission of weakness,
yep.
which they translate to mean that they're less of a man if they're weak. If they mm-hmm. even go to the doctor for a checkup, or if they mm-hmm. go to a therapist to talk about what they're feeling. And I think the healthiest and the strongest men that I know, they go to therapy, they get physicals, the doctor, they get their colonoscopy done
mm-hmm.
when they're yes. required.
Oh God,
to.
Don't talk
things.
About the colonoscopy.
You said what?
I said don't talk about the colonoscopy. I know many men they're not having it.
Yeah.
It's sad.
Yeah,
it's
I
really
know,
sad.
I know. That's a good recipe to not live. You know what I mean? Like
yeah.
that's for real, man. You can feel any way you want about it, but it's like you got to do that. You know, so it's
Carlos.
You know,
I have to interrupt you. Hold that thought.
Sure.
We're going to go to a break, and we'll be right back, and we'll revisit your thought.
We interrupt this broadcast to bring you a great opportunity. If you have a product or a service, a talent or something important to say, now's your chance to have your very own radio show. Whether you're just starting out, a veteran looking for a professional platform to enhance your presentation, the GoPro Radio Network is the premier place to cultivate and share new and exciting content. We'll help you to grow your audience and keep it growing long after your first broadcast. Now you have a voice. Call 212-696-8562 today or visit www.goproradio.com and you'll be amazed at how easy and affordable it is to have your very own show on the fastest growing network in the galaxy. GoPro Radio Network. Listen to the voices in your head.
You're listening to content developed by the GoPro Radio Network, the fastest growing network in the galaxy. GoPro Radio Network. Listen to the voices in your head.
All right, welcome back. This is Nina and Shauna on
Hello.
On the GoPro Radio Network, and we have our wonderful guest, Carlos Andres Gomez.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to ask you again, because you didn't really ask, because actually it's my fault because I asked you two questions in one. I wanted to ask you what your opinion was of GMOs linked to gluten sensitivity and what you think about that. What is your personal opinion on that?
Yeah, I mean, my personal opinion is GMOs are the cause of a lot of problems. And I don't know if I'm honestly not informed enough about the research.
Mm-hmm.
Or the findings right now to know what linkages have been made, but I think I ate so much preservative crap with all the healthy things that my mom gave me. I still ate so many things with preservatives and things that were not good for me growing up and living in different parts of the world.
Mm-hmm.
I definitely think there's a link between that and my gluten intolerance and my food intolerances in general. And I think so many things that you see now about where you see how young kids develop now and how young kids enter puberty. When you talk about GMOs, when you talk about all the engineering that's been done with our food to meet the
yes.
sort of insatiable demand, especially in the United States,
mm-hmm.
of our food consumption, I think that, it's pretty hard. To me, it's like denying climate change to
right.
say that GMOs are not in some way linked to not just food intolerances, but also obesity and a lot of other health issues we see rampant in the United States, especially.
Now, I know you recently, I follow you on Facebook, and you recently posted that you did a 30-day vegan diet, and I'm a vegan, so
yeah.
I was interested in how that made you, especially because you're already so limited in terms of the things that you can eat, then to even further limit yourself, I thought was very interesting. So can you talk about what that experience was like for you?
Yes. My wife and I did the vegan challenge for 30 days. Obviously, there were a lot, probably even more limited than vegans traditionally are, because I also couldn't do wheat gluten or peanuts or mushrooms, which I know vegans love.
Mm-hmm.
It was interesting.
Be honest.
No, I'll be honest.
Okay.
I eat very healthy regularly, and mm-hmm. I eat a lot of vegetables in my everyday life.
Excellent.
I didn't actually feel better going vegan for 30 days, to be honest.
Okay.
My energy was lower. You know, we ate a lot of legumes, and we were very aware of protein and
mm-hmm.
trying to get all the things that I know on a vegan diet you have to be very aware of. We plotted it out very meticulously, but I didn't feel better. I actually felt worse, to be honest.
Oh, interesting. What about your wife? How was her?
She didn't feel better either, which is not what we were expecting, to be
here,
honest.
Here.
Oh, that's interesting.
So I don't know. I mean, if I was, you know, Jay-Z or Beyonce and I had a 5 Michelin starred vegan chef, I'm sure that might have been, I might have had a very different experience.
Yeah.
And if I had $800 million in the bank, I probably would have a vegan chef on hand at all times.
All right, exactly.
But considering that we both have very crazy schedules, mm-hmm. and we went to great lengths to try to do it as healthy as possible, and we were mm-hmm. actually totally disciplined. We both did the full 30 days all the way vegan.
Wow.
But, I was surprised. I didn't feel better. I think I could definitely do vegetarian without a doubt. I love.
Mm-hmm.
I'm totally fine being vegetarian. I'm not vegetarian, but I've gone for different spans being vegetarian. But
mm-hmm.
vegan for me was, I don't know. I don't know if it's for me.
Well, I don't think, I mean, personally, and I said this a few weeks ago, I don't think every kind of diet is for everyone. I think some people are just meant to eat meat. Some people are meant to be vegans. I have a friend whose daughter, since the time she was little, had an aversion to meat, and to this day she's a vegan and she's fine with it.
Her
parents are not like that. They are meat eaters, but she is not. So I think a lot of it is, you know, just the way you are, the way you're born. Some of it is genetic.
Sure.
Some people are meat eaters, some people are not, you know.
Yeah, but I could say that honestly for me, like, I don't have low energy, so I'm not affected in that way. So, but
so
I think it is working for me. But I like to hear other
vegetables though.
I do. I eat too much. I'm a starchitarian, really.
Yeah,
all right. So Carlos, you know, we mentioned that you are a poet, and I thought it'd be great. We have only 4 minutes left, so I thought it'd be great if you can bless us with a little something before
yes,
the
please,
show
please.
Ends.
Do you have anything?
Sure.
Awesome.
So what is it? What is it, a Wednesday?
Yes,
it is.
It's Ash Wednesday.
Cool. it's Ash Wednesday. My gosh, sorry, Mohammed. So I'm sure you know it's a Wednesday night. We're almost to the weekend. So I'll do a little piece about dancing, and it's called Hector Lavoe is God.
Ooh.
For all the Latino Latinas, all the salseros and salseras.
Gracias.
And it goes like this. I just might get her to stand up. But for now, she's moving in her seat, playing it cool while I flirt. Heave the timbales into my hips. It's a Saturday night in Northeast Philly. But she and I might as well be at the Colosseum in Rome. Julius Caesar watching with a smirk, drunk on my bravado, and she's still sitting. But that doesn't mean we ain't dancing. Doesn't mean we ain't pulsing at the center of this dance floor like a swollen heart about to thread itself inside out, my eyes closed, sweat soaked, the bass guitar in clave, she spins me in an awkward turn around her. Awkward. Like Mona Lisa's stained smile or Da Vinci's backward scrawl, you need a mirror to read awkward. Like Michael Jordan taken off from the foul line, his body contorting impossibly, improvised double clutch surprise freeze frame before slamming the ball through the rim, shock stung like Audre Lorde, dropping 4 bars on a Miles Davis remix of Tupac's I Get Around. The way she spins me is awkward. With an ounce of sacrifice, grace, or greatness, she just might stand up, I swear to God. And tonight that God is Hector Lavoe. But right now she's still in her wheelchair, her torso writhing like a baby about to burst forth into this world, her open smile blessing the ceiling like an incantation to the bullet that didn't spare her baby brother. It's 11:17 in Northeast Philly on a Saturday night. El Cantante's band is helping him sing out a sermon, and I'm just waiting for her to rise up out of her wheelchair into a salsa drop step. She reminds me that as long as we got music like this in our bones, we can never, never be stopped from dancing.
That was beautiful.
That was awesome.
Love it.
It's interesting because I just posted on my Facebook on Saturday that I was in the mood for dancing. I don't know if you saw that, Shauna.
I did.
I was like, I am in the mood for dancing.
I love it.
Oh, all so right. Much. Well, thank you so much, Carlos. We really appreciate having you on the show and sharing your story with us. And
Do you have any up and coming projects that you want to talk about or plug, by the way? I'm sure you have many.
What was that?
Do you have any projects that you'd like to plug? Anything coming up that we should
right
know about?
Yeah, right now I'm actually on the road right now. I'm on my way to Vermont tomorrow. I'm doing a lot of shows promoting the book. And I have a lot of upcoming gigs and projects. But if people want to find out any more, they can go to my website, which is www.carloslive.com.
And where can people purchase
the
book?
Information's on there. They can get it right on there, too, right on the opening page.
Awesome.
They can get the book. And it's called Man Up, Reimagining Modern Manhood.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. I want to, you know, we have to give a shout out to our engineer, Tatiana Washington. We have to give a shout out to Ayanna Jones, Muhammad Asafi, our production assistants, our assistant, Tayana Washington, and the Sexy Party Show is up next.
And
we also want
to give a shout out to Glenn Zarmanoff.
Who's actually
shadowing Muhammad.
All right. Thanks, Glenn. We will see you guys next week. Have a good night. Peace.
Peace out. Peace out.
and I'm hungry.
Is you looking for good eating? Then stay beating the path to the network with the best rapper. Hook you up fast. They keep it crispy with the 411. They feeding you right. Chopping it up, dishing it out. It's tasting good, but don't bite. For recipes and sublime and info fresh off the vine. They keep you GMO free, because be you all what you eat. Now if you too busy chewing on the FAT fat wag, tune into the F to the O to the O to D food rap. Listen to the kitchen on the show with the utmost. We need me and Shauna G, your fly MC chef host.
Food rap.
It's time to eat better. I know you feel the pressure. Can I get a yes, yes, sir?
Yes, sir.
For the hot show on the block, from the street to the hood. Keep it locked. On food rappers talk. Never tasted so good.
Oh, yeah, delicious. Pizzas, hamburgers, and french fries. Oh, yeah. All the fast food I can eat. Oh, no, I can't have it. Oh, no. I'm hungry. I hear my stomach.
Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio. Goodbye.
I'm